Cloud and contractility, because the performance of the heart, the yes, the performance quite of stroke volume, but I would say more performance, because stroke volume also depends on heart rate. Here the performance, how much and how strong the ventricle can contract. This is the performance. This systolic performance only depends on afterload, preload, and contractility. So afterload is the load against we need to eject the blood. This afterload is approximately the mean arterial pressure. So if we increase the resistance, the vascular resistance, we increase the afterload. This is mean arterial pressure is equal to the total peripheral resistance times cardiac output. The afterload is the mean arterial pressure, more or less, it's an index. So if we increase the total peripheral resistance, we increase the mean arterial pressure, and so we increase the afterload. We will touch pathology associated with this a little bit later in the video. Next, the preload is the load that the heart has before the contraction, before systole. That is the load that the heart has at the end of diastole, in the relaxing state. This is the same as in skeletal muscle. The preload is the load that the muscle has before the stretching, before the contraction. So here, this is the blood that the heart needs to eject. This is the preload. The preload is the load that we have before ejecting. This load that we have is the blood. Alright. Now, returning to this and Frank Starling, this is in preload. When we increase preload, we are increasing this sarcomere link. So, this is myosin. And this is actin. In contraction, what happens is the actin and myosin, the superposition increases. So we will pass from this state to, let's say, this state. Actin, like this, and myosin will be like this. We have a lot of superposition. Yes. Alright. So this is the relaxed state and this is the contracted state. And the contraction, maximum contraction, that is the maximum movement of myosin and actin that we can have, the maximum superposition depends on the relaxed state. If we have this versus this, this is a very relaxed state. That in the relaxed state we have a lot of dilation. When we contract, we will only do that the superposition be like this. So it wouldn't be like this. This is a very good superposition. So this is not the perfect state. So if we increase the preload very much, we dilate very much the ventricle, and so we are in this position, in the relaxing state, and when we contract to here, and this is not what we want. Also, if we begin with a very little preload, this is like this, so we have a lot of superposition because the sarcomere length is not very increased. If the sarcomere length is very little, because we are putting very little preload, so this is with very little preload, and so if we have this superposition, this is very this state has a much very much superposition, and because we have very much superposition, we cannot superpose them more in the contraction. So nor this, nor this. So if we have very little preload, it is not the maximum or the most the better performance that we can produce with this preload. This is the better performance that we can produce. This is the relaxed state with the dilation of the ventricle that produces the better performance. So, nor too much preload, nor very little preload. So, the Frank-Starling forces is that as we increase preload, we are increasing the sarcomere length, and so we are passing from this, we are separating them, so we pass from here to here. And now this is the best relaxing state. This is the preload that we are putting that leads to this dilation is the preload that will produce the maximum performance. So this state is the better. If we put more preload here, so we will decrease the superposition all the way until here, and this would not produce a very good performance because the contraction is not good. We cannot contract very well, so we need to be here. So in order to have the maximum performance, we need to put some preload. Yes, we put some preload, but if we pass, if we put much preload, then we would end up with this. So if we graph here, let's say stroke volume, and here preload, as we increase the preload, we increase stroke volume all the way until some point. That point is when we arrive to this state, where when we are passing from here to here, the curve is flattening, because then we cannot eject more than what we were ejecting here. And even this can go even a little bit down if we have a very length in the sarcomere. If the length is very large, then we could begin to have a decreased ejection or stroke volume than we would have here. So these are the Frank-Starling forces. Now that we talk about preload and afterload, this is, we put the tension curve. This is, here I would put tension, and here I would put a load. If we put the some load to the muscle in preload, in checking preload, this is passive tension, is the tension that the heart has at the end of putting the preload. So here we are talking about diastole. Diastole is or preload occurs in diastole, and when we have the load against the ventricle has to contract, that's the afterload, and so afterload occurs in systole. Systole, afterload. Alright, so now we are graphing here we are graphing the preload against the tension. This tension could be the passive tension or active tension. So passive tension is passive tension is the tension in diastole before contracting, and active tension is in contraction. That is, active tension is the tension that we are generating, that the muscle is generating. The passive tension is the tension that someone is putting to the heart. This is, for example, in the muscle. Passive tension of the muscle is if we put some load. Active tension is if we contract. In here, the passive tension is when the heart is being filled. The active tension is when the heart is contracted. So the passive tension is, yes, as we increase the preload, we increase the passive tension. Looks like this. If we increase the preload, yes, as we increase the preload, we increase by Frank-Starling forces the length of the sarcomere, and up to a point the stroke volume would be greater, and so the afterload the afterload increases this, going like this, until a point. This point is when this length of the sarcomere is very strong, and so we go down. So this is active tension, and this is passive tension. This passive tension we can measure as compliance, how compliance is the ventricle, in a sense, could be an index. Alright, now, for contractility before entering to pathology, for contractility is the force of contraction. This force of contraction is for a given preload, for a given heart rate, for a given afterload, how strong we are contracting, and yes, if we increase the contraction force, we increase the blood that we can eject, because it's not the same to contract like this than contract like this. We would send more blood. And this is an increase in stroke volume, and so an increase in cardiac output. And yes, and when we increase contractility, many things happen. First, as we increase contractility, we are decreasing preload, because if we increase contractility, we are sending a larger stroke volume, and so we have less blood in the heart. So decreases the preload. Even though I have a debate about this, because that stroke volume that we are sending is going to return, and so that returning then is going to feel again the heart. And so, in a sense, I think that is some magic that we say it like that, because that would return. But anyway, this is not like this. Next, if we increase contractility, we are increasing the sequestration of the calcium, and so the relaxing time is faster, so we are sequestrating, and a little bit like if we increase heart rate, the sequestration and release of the calcium from the sarcoplasmic reticulum is increased, so this happens also. Acute changes in contractility are because changes in calcium, but long-term changes in or chronic changes in contractility are main because of some dysfunction now of the systolic dysfunction or something like that, because the heart, because of myocardial infarction or something like that. But acute changes are because we increase calcium. For example, the hydropyridine blockers, calcium channel blockers, non-dihydropyridine like verapamil, is a calcium channel blocker. If we give that to this patient, the calcium cannot enter to the cardiac muscle, and if the calcium cannot enter the cardiac muscle, the contraction force decreases. And this is an acute change. Alright. Other thing that happens is the derivative, that is dP in dt. This is the change in pressure in the change in time increases. This is, yes, when we contract the ventricle, we increase the blood pressure. Yes, we increase the blood pressure. But if we increase the force of contraction, this contraction will is stronger, and so the blood that we are sending increases, and if we increase the blood that we are sending, we are increasing blood pressure. And so, in the same interval, heart rate is not being modified. If we just increase the force of contraction, we are sending more blood. Sending more blood increases the blood pressure in the same time. So, in that little time, we can take very little time. At the beginning, we have some change in pressure, but now, because we increase the contraction force, we have more blood pressure, more increase in blood pressure in that same time. So the dp in dt increases. This could be an index, even though the force of contraction, that is contractility, the units are newtons. It's a force. Here we are measuring pressure is newton per square meter divided by time. This would be second. But anyway, this newton divided by second, this could be kilogram meter square meter per square second divided by meter square divided by second And anyway, I can continue with this, but this is more like physics units. Alright. So, we were talking about contractility. Things that also increase contractility is the agonist, beta 1 adrenergic receptor agonist, or sympathetic pathway that increases the beta 1 adrenergic receptor firing, well, receiving the epinephrine or norepinephrine. If we activate these beta 1 receptors at the end, because this is a receptor, G-coupled receptor, GS-coupled receptor, we increase cyclic AMP, and this cyclic AMP goes and releases the catalytic subunits of protein kinase A, and protein kinase A just phosphorylates many things. First, phosphorylates the calcium channels, and so we have more calcium entering, and so we can contract, and so we have more calcium, the contraction increases. The other is we phosphorylate the protein phosphobulam. Phosphobulam is a protein that when it is phosphorylated, it is inactive. Phosphobulam inactivates CERCA. CERCA is the enzyme that the protein that returns the calcium from the cytoplasm to the cytoplasmic reticulum. If we inhibit phosphobulam when we phosphorylate it, we increase CERCA, increase CERCA activity, increase CERCA activity, sequester or returns the calcium to the sarcoplasmic reticulum faster, and so we can relax and contract faster because this increase in CERCA activity. Other things that modify the contractility are the acidosis. Acidosis decreases contraction force. We have some pumps, natrium calcium exchangers. This is we enter 3 natriums and out 1 calcium. If we decrease this ratio, the activity of this pump, we have more calcium here because we are not sending out, and so this would increase the contractility. If we decrease this, like in digoxin indirectly, this would lead to a if we increase this, like in no, if we decrease this, we decrease this like in digoxin, then we will increase the contractility because digoxin blocks the natrium calcium ATPase. So we have more natrium here, and if we have more natrium here, there is no need to send natrium here because we have here, and so we do not send natrium here. Calcium not go out, calcium stay here, and so we increase the contractility. All right. In pathology, we have for afterload, we have an increased afterload, hypertension. Increase in afterload leads to the ventricle, could lead to some dysfunction of the ventricle, but first, the mechanism of compensation. We have 2 formulas. Laplace law is tension is equal to pressure times radius, and wall stress is equal to tension divided by wall thickness, 2 times the wall thickness. Alright, so if we have increase in the afterload, let's say we increase the mean arterial pressure, we can increase mean arterial pressure, we increase tension. So we increase the tension of the ventricle. So what can happen if we increase the tension of the ventricle? Compensation is constrictive hypertrophy. If we increase the wall thickness here in wall stress is equal to tension divided by wall thickness. If we increase the wall thickness, the wall stress is going to get down. So for that, the compensation in a increase in afterload is a concentric hypertrophy because that decreases the wall stress. Next, if we increase the preload, let's say aortic insufficiency, so at the end of diastole we have more blood. That produces a eccentric hypertrophy. This is the sarcomere are being put in series, like this. So, we are increasing the radius, and if we increase the radius, here we increase the radius, yes, the tension increases and wall stress increases. So this can lead to some at the end dilated cardiomyopathy and then congestive heart failure. But because we are increasing wall stress, because we are increasing the ratio, the radius. Also, this is the compensation also for, oh, in congestive heart failure, we also see this. We have an increase in preload, and this increase in preload produces the dilation of the cardiac muscle at the in congestive heart failure. Alright, returning to the concentric hypertrophy, here we have two things that decreases wall stress. One, that we increase the wall thickness. The denominator increases, so the wall thickness decreases. And other, the radius is decreasing. Instead of being from here to here, it is from here to here. So the radius decreases, and if we decrease the radius, we decrease the tension. And if we decrease the tension, we decrease the wall stress. And in hypertrophic cardiomyopathy, this is a increase in the wall thickness of the ventricle, but without a change in pressure.